this force, it won't prevail. 'Cause the God I serve knows only how to triumph. My God will never fail. Oh, my God will never fail. I'm gonna see a victory. I'm gonna see a victory. For the battle belongs to you, Lord. I'm gonna see a victory. I'm gonna see a victory.
He who was before there was light walked across the pages of time. He who made every living thing, behold him. He who heard humanity's cry left his throne to wake as a child. He became like the least of us. Behold him. Jesus, Son of God, Messiah, the Lamb, the roaring lion. Oh, be still and behold him.
Good morning. Welcome to Deer Park Church this morning. We're so glad you're here. This is a wonderful day to worship the Lord. Most of you are aware that today is Palm Sunday, and so we're heading into Easter week. And as we do, I want to make note of the fact that this last week we had two incredible performances. Lots of you don't know that our building is incredibly well used during the week. We have Arabic believers on Friday night downstairs. We have Bible study. We have youth, young adults. Wednesdays, the ACA Christian homeschooling group meets downstairs. And on Friday night, they had a concert here, a kids' concert. And it was phenomenal. And the message was loud and clear. And if you see helium balloons in the ceiling, that is why. And they will come down. But it was an incredible encouragement to our heart to see young kids praising Jesus. And then on the weekend, of course, was the pregnancy care play. And I have to admit that we know so well the story of Easter, but watching it being acted and sang like that made me weep. It was an incredible reminder of what our God did for us. Amen. And what talent is in our church communities in general, but also from Deer Park, because I was counting, and there is a lot of you that were in it, so thank you, and I'm sure some of you are sleeping because you're exhausted. But just a great reminder that we're heading into this Easter season. Tomorrow morning, Tabitha ladies are meeting at 10 o'clock. Also, we had an Easter breakfast this morning, beautifully put on by Marion and Norbert and their kitchen crew, and so again, that was wonderful, great time to fellowship. Next Friday, 10 o'clock, we're doing a joint Good Friday service with Kentwood. We're doing it here, so 10 o'clock, Good Friday service. And then Sunday morning, we're going to gather together to celebrate the risen Christ, because that's why we meet, isn't it? Because Jesus did not stay in the tomb. He is alive and risen. I have one special announcement this morning. We are excited to have in our midst a new family that just arrived from the Ukraine via Poland, Marina, Daniel and Michael, they're over there. Can you wave your arm or stand? Yes? Yes, welcome. They are in a motel signing a lease for an apartment tomorrow, and hopefully we have an apartment for them for April 1st. But of course, they came with only the clothes. And so as a church family, we would like to furnish and supply what they need. And so I am going to be collecting stuff. So if you have beds, all in good shape, if you have beds, dressers, bedding, kitchen pots and pans, utensils, towels, basically what you need to set up an apartment, we would like to do that during this week. And I know we can because we've done it twice before in the 6 years we've been here. You guys are a generous church family, so I'll be in the foyer after. But we all have, I just commented that I went through my towels a few weeks ago and I gave all three of my, two of my daughters and my daughter-in-law, a huge bag of towels, and I still have too many towels. And they were probably all wedding gifts from 36 years ago. And so we all have too much. And so please be looking for what you can give to help provide for this family. And again, welcome. I want to read for you as we head into worship. Matthew 21, and it's Jesus. Today is Palm Sunday, so it's Jesus's triumphal entry into Jerusalem. As they approached Jerusalem and came to Bethpage on the Mount of Olives, Jesus sent two disciples, saying to them, "Go to the village ahead of you, and at once you will find a donkey tied there with her colt by her. Untie them and bring them to me." And then verse 6. The disciples went and did as Jesus instructed. They brought the donkey and the colt and placed their cloaks on them for Jesus to sit on. A large crowd spread their cloaks on the ground, while others cut branches from the trees and spread them on the ground. The crowds then went ahead of them, shouting, "Hosanna to the Son of David! Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord! Hosanna in the highest!" And so as a church family, let's join together in praising Jesus.
Yes, I invite you to stand with us as we sing Hosanna to our King.
Thank you.
presence, all our fears are washed away. Let's sing that again. 'Cause when we see you, we find strength to face the day. In your presence, all our fears are washed away, washed away. Thank you. of every blessing, tune my heart to sing thy grace. Streams of mercy never ceasing, calls for songs of loudest praise. Teach me some melodious sonnet, sung by flaming tongues above. Praise the mount I'm fixed upon it, mount of thy lost in utter darkness until you came and rescued me. And I was bound by all my sin when your love came and set me free. Now my soul can sing a new song. Now my heart has found a home. Now your grace is always with me, and I'll never be alone. Come thou fount, come thou King, come thou precious Prince of Peace. Hear your bride, to you we sing, come thou fount of our blessing. To grace, how great a debtor daily I'm constrained to be. Let thy goodness like a fetter bind my wandering heart to thee. Prone to my heart, Lord, take and seal it for thy courts above. Come thou fount, come thou King, come thou precious Prince of Peace. Hear your bride, one with God, the Lord Most High. Your hidden glory in creation, now revealed in you are Christ. What a beautiful name it is. What a beautiful name. Beautiful name it is. Nothing compares to this. What a beautiful name it is. The name of Jesus. is greater. What could say?
Amen. Thanks to the worship team for leading us. We'll ask the congregation please be seated. We'll have the ushers come forward as we prepare to take our morning tithes and offerings. And I just want to say a thanks to you for praying for Marnie and I as well as we were away on holiday. Certainly enjoyed our time. It was very relaxing. It's always nice to get back home, though, as well. So thanks for your prayers. As we continue, let's take an opportunity to bow together. Lord, you've heard our words as we've sung. Our heart to lift up our praise and worship to you. You alone are worthy of our praise. No rival, no equal. You are the only true and living God. We're so thankful, Lord, that you have shown yourself to us. You've been merciful to us through Christ. And we're so thankful, Lord, that we can lift up our voice in praise and worship and adoration today, Lord. And as we bow here, we invite your searching through our hearts, Lord, because we confess how easily we worship other things. Lord, our comfort, our health, material things we enjoy, ourselves, forgive me. Lord, forgive us. And may it be true of us that we would worship and serve you most of all, Lord. Draw us towards you. We love you and we worship you and we need you, Lord. We're so thankful for your goodness to us, for your grace and mercy, for the freedoms that we enjoy here, for material things that we enjoy, for families that you've made us a part of. For all, we know that all we have comes from you. Health that we enjoy, hope that we have because of Jesus. Friends, thank you, Lord. Thank you for this Easter season as we're reminded again of your amazing love for us. So thankful for the hope we have because of Jesus and his willingness to die for us, to pay for our sins, to open up the way to heaven, Lord. Thank you for that. And Lord, as we bow here, we're so thankful that you know each of us by name. You know our thoughts. You know our needs. We lift them up before you. I continue to pray for Mel and Heidi, that you be merciful to them, Lord. Draw close to them. Give them your grace and strength today. And for Gordon and Lois, Lord, we pray you'd walk with them. Concern for kids who are far from you, Lord, or grandkids. We pray that you'd be drawing them to yourself, Lord. Thank you. We know that's your desire, Lord. We want to pray they would humble themselves before you, recognize their need of you, reach out to you, pray for believers in place of influence, Lord, that you would use them. And Lord, in our world, there are how many tragedies, how many challenges. We pray for peace in Jerusalem, for the Middle East. We pray for believers there, Lord, that you'd use them to show your grace and love, even in the terrible situation. Pray for peace in Ukraine as well, Lord, and I pray for believers there also, that you would use them and strengthen them, encourage them. And we're thankful, Lord, that you're at work many, many places in our world, drawing people to yourself. Thank you. I want to pray for Marie as well as she goes out on the missions trip very soon. We just pray that you're looking after Marie and a group there, that they would know you're with them, provide for their needs, and use them in the Dominican Republic, we pray. Thank you. And for each of us as well, Lord, that we'd have care and love and compassion for those who are far from you. Use us, give us eyes to see those who are lost around us, Lord. And we continue to pray, thank you, Lord, for the kids in our congregation. Thank you for those who teach week by week. Bless them, encourage them, and use them, Lord. We pray for the young ones in our church family. They would grow up to know you and to follow you throughout their days. Give extra grace and wisdom to parents with young children as well in these days, we pray. Thank you. And Lord, we thank you for all you bless us with. Pray that as we give, we would do so with joyful hearts. We give you thanks in Jesus' name. Amen. As the offering is being taken, we'll have the children dismissed to their classes.
Stand before your throne.
Amen. Thank you again to the worship team. Just a note, we're going to finish up our I Am series next Sunday with the I Am the Resurrection and the Life, so we're looking forward to Easter Sunday. But for now, we're taking a little break, but we're glad to have Kory with us. Kory is going to come up here. Many of you have had connections with Camp Servicides over the years, and Corey's been working there now. I think he's going to 2 years he's done. Okay. So great to have Kory with us. He's going to share a little bit about camp, and also he'll be preaching. I'm just going to pray for Kory as he gets started here this morning. Lord, as we bow here, you know our hearts. You know our needs. We invite you to be working in us, Lord, to encourage us, to challenge us, to change us. I pray for Kory, Lord, that you give him the extra grace and the strength that he needs today, a sense of your presence, and that by his words, he would be sharing your heart with us today and just calling us to draw close to you and to continue to serve you. Thank you that we can be here today. Thank you for Kory. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you,
Kory. Amen. Thank you, Pastor Andrew. Yeah, I'm going to wear three different hats here. I'm going to start with the one just as Kory. And I just want to thank those of you that have been praying for my family and checking in on us. It's coming up to 1 year since our niece Sophia passed away. So our two significant days are Easter Sunday and April 9th. And so it's a journey that only God is somehow going to use for good because it's been a long one. And so thank you for that. The second one I'm just going to throw on here is my Camp Silversides hat. And I don't want to take too long with this. I just want to thank this church for, there are a number of you that have come out either as campers. We've got volunteers that have come. We have young people that come and are our counselors out there. And there's going to be a picture coming up that I just want to talk about right away. Because this is the picture of camp. We have all these ideas of the fun and stuff that goes on, but this was our teen camp that we had last year. And this was just this spontaneous outpouring one night at the campfire where the teens that were there just all collectively just needed to get up to be close to Jesus because they had been looking and looking, and we had these amazing speakers that it started with. It was actually one that was talking about challenges they've had since they had been sexually abused, and this connected with such a group of our campers. And it's like, how could Jesus love me? And it kept going on, and it's just like, guys, you measure up to who Jesus is. All you got to do is accept it. And they came, and they just wanted to be close to the cross to pray. And the next night, it continued. For over 3 hours, it was just a lineup of these campers wanting to give testimony that God had changed their life. And they were sharing stories that kids shouldn't be having, but they do. But it was changed from mourning to tears of, God has saved me. And so as you think of camp, as you think of Camp Silversides, we're approaching 100 years of being in ministry here in central Alberta. We're just on Gull Lake, about 25 minutes north, right beside Bentley. And we are just praying that God, you have sustained us for this long, position us for these next 100 years that you're calling us to. And to do that, we are going to rely on him and his people. And so we're looking for 100 new people to be praying for us as a camp ministry. Our mission is to find those that have the least opportunity to hear about Jesus and tell them. That means that I'm in interactions with school counselors to say, do you have kids that need a summer camp? We're going to get them there. I want people praying for those meetings. We're looking for 100 new financial partners to help us. We just made a decision this week, our leadership. It was a hard one, but it's one we took where with the Canada Summer Jobs Grant, we bring in about 50 young people to be on staff for a summer, either for the whole summer, May to August, or just for a few weeks. And we just didn't feel comfortable with some of the things that we had to agree to on the Canada Summer Jobs Grant. That's $150,000 that we're just going to count on God to provide for us. We're also looking amongst that churches that that not just individuals in the churches, but churches will say, do you know what? We're going to be in your corner, Camp Silversides. We want to be part of what you're doing and looking for partners that way. And the other thing is, we're looking for 100 new volunteers, people that want to come and serve and be part of these sorts of moments for young people to come and hear the good news and leave forever changed about Jesus. So that's the Camp Silversides hat. It's an exciting one. I love it. I'm going to just put on the opportunity to share this morning, and I'm going to start just by asking for a grace to you. I was very excited, and I still am, to be able to share from the Word this morning. It's been hard for me to study and learn since Sophia passed away, but I told Pastor Andrew, like, I'm really excited about what the Lord has put on my heart. But Thursday, my best friend died. He was 40 years old, and he just passed away in his sleep. He's got a beautiful wife and three kids, and so we've been with them for the last few days. And so I didn't start writing my sermon on Thursday. I've been working on it. But how far did I get? I got up to the conclusion. I never got it finished. So we're going to finish it together today. And I might read a little bit more than normally I would like to, but that's okay. And so the other thing that I never got done that is probably obvious is that I never had time to get a haircut. And so I didn't get a conclusion and I didn't get a haircut, but the Lord is going to use our time today. Just a little background on how I came to this topic today. I've started thinking a little bit differently about Easter. Easter week, Palm Sunday today, we have Good Friday and Resurrection Day. It kind of has this rhythm of happy. Today's the happy day, Friday's sad, and then Sunday is happy again. The services generally reflect this, and over the last number of years, I've just really adopted, as a follower of Jesus, an approach that just says, Jesus, I just want to know you more. I just want to know Jesus. I've had seasons of exploring the big theologies of our faith and Christian doctrines. I've wrestled with concepts that are hard and mysteries that we're not fully going to know until we get to heaven. I've tackled the dense topics that can put you to sleep, like, did Adam have a belly button? We don't know. But in the last 15 years, and while I'm confident that my foundation in doctrine and theology has helped, and it's needed more today than ever, I've just wanted to know Jesus more. I've desired to become more like Jesus in my actions, in my values, in my behaviors, my character. I want to act and react as Jesus did. I want to treat people like Jesus did and care for them. And the more I've gotten to know Jesus, the less concerned I've become with the things that are the mysteries, the things that just require faith. I'm fine just having faith in that. I just want to know and be more like Jesus. And as my life journey has taken me on various roads, I've met more people and had more conversation where I've become more convinced that people today are not searching for a theological debate or answers to the mysteries of Jesus. They just want to know, is Jesus real? And if Jesus is real, would he save me? To be able to give them that answer, the answer that they need, I think we need to re-examine our view of the cross and what happened on it. One of the phrases that bothers me, I'm going to offend some of you, I know it and you'll forgive me. It happens on Good Friday. It's Friday, but Sunday's coming. We say it as soon as we wake. It's Friday, but Sunday's coming. Why are we trying to get away from the cross so fast? This is a big day. This is a big moment. I think you could make an argument that this is the biggest moment. 1 Corinthians 1:18, it says, "For the message of the cross is foolishness to those who are perishing. For those of us being saved, it's the power of God." The Jesus that I want to be like, who said, "You, Kory, have to take up a cross if you want to follow me. You have to suffer. You have to lose your life if you want to gain the life that I have for you." I think there's more for us to learn if we just stop and we stay at the cross and discover the power that came through it. The passage we're going to explore today is Philippians 3, 10, and 11. You can open up your Bibles there and just keep your finger there. We're going to skip around, but it says, "I want to know Christ." Yes, to know the power of his resurrection and participation in his suffering, becoming like him in his death, and so somehow attaining to the resurrection from the dead. I want to know Christ, or as people today are saying, is Jesus real? The Jesus Storybook Bible, if you have kids, or just get one and read it, it has this catchphrase, "Every story whispers his name." The message is just saying that throughout the entire Bible, it is pointing to Jesus, and they're not wrong. Within the Old Testament, there are at least 300 prophecies about the Messiah. We didn't know it was Jesus, it was the Messiah, the Savior that they were talking about. There might be as many as 450, depending who you're talking to. And so a prophecy is a word given through a messenger of God, called a prophet, on behalf of God. And so there are 300 of these signs, messages pointing to God, written over thousands of years by authors that didn't know each other and somehow point to Jesus. These prophecies cover things like Jesus' entry to Jerusalem today. It's in Zechariah 9:9, 500 years earlier. "See, your king comes to you, righteous and victorious, lowly, riding on a donkey, on a colt, the foal of a donkey." The Messiah, born of a virgin, in Isaiah 7, it says, "Therefore the Lord himself said, I will give you a sign. The virgin will conceive and give birth to a son and call him Emmanuel." Listen to this one. What imagery does it give you? "My mouth is dried up like a potsherd." That's a shattered piece of pottery. "And my tongue sticks to the roof of my mouth. You lay me in the dust of death. Dogs surround me. A pack of villains encircles me. They pierce my hands and my feet. All my bones are on display. People stare and gloat over me. They divide my clothes among them and cast lots for my garments." That's Psalm 22. And that imagery is so much of the crucifixion of Jesus. Yet, it was written 600 years before crucifixion had been invented. These are prophecies of Jesus. So several Old Testament prophecies about the Messiah have been fulfilled. What's the likelihood that one person could fulfill these things? The answer to fulfilling 48, 100, 200, 300, it's too hard for my brain to understand. So we're going to look at the probability of eight prophecies of Jesus from the Old Testament about the Messiah being fulfilled by one individual. The likelihood of eight prophecies written in the Old Testament being fulfilled by the same person is the same likelihood as me taking a single loonie and putting my initials on it. and then covering the entire province of Alberta in loonies, 2 feet deep, so to the height of your armrest. The whole province, north to south, east to west, all in loonies. And then me taking this one I put my initials on and mixing it into the batch. The likelihood isn't of us going and searching for it. The likeliness is of us selecting one person and blindfolding them and saying, you can walk wherever you want, and then you have to reach down and you can take one coin. There's a mathematical number that explains that, but I've just used the picture. That's the likelihood of 8 of these prophecies being fulfilled. If it was 16 of the prophecies, it would be that same experiment, but the distance would be 30 times the distance of the earth to the sun. And over 300 of these were fulfilled. There is no question, zero, in my mind, that Jesus is real. I want to know Christ, Paul says. We can. Yes, to know the power of his resurrection. This is referring to the forgiveness of sins that every single one of us can receive by simply confessing that Jesus is Lord. And then because Jesus is real and he's already accomplished all these other things, I have so much confidence that to attain to the resurrection from the dead, that's talking about him coming back to take us home to heaven, that's going to happen. I'm not wondering about that anymore, because everything else has lined up that says Jesus is real, I know I'm saved, and I know he's going to take me home. For many of us, this sounds complete. No Jesus, accept forgiveness for your sins, and one day we get to go to heaven. It sounds whole. Sungchan Ra, he's a Korean professor and pastor. He describes this as the theology of celebration, and it comes when we focus on the battle that's already won, because there is a battle already won. So our priority is on maintaining and stewarding our abundance. We have benefited both spiritually and materially from the victory that Jesus had. Life is already healthy, complete. We feel pretty good about it. It has its hiccup, of course, but victory has been achieved. Maintaining the status quo is our priority, and God is a nurturing figure. This is the theology of the resurrection. The hard part has already been taken care of. Our verse, if we took out the middle part of it, it would read, I want to know Jesus, the power of his resurrection, and attain to the resurrection from the dead. I'm saved from my sins. I'm receiving the blessing of being saved. And when I die, I'll go to heaven. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. It's true. But it's not complete. What do we do with the middle of Philippians 3:10? Participation in his sufferings, becoming like him in his death. The New Living Translation, it says, I want to suffer with him. I want to suffer with Jesus, sharing in his death. It's easy. We can just instead say, it's Friday, Sunday is coming. No, we can't. We've become big fans of The Chosen in our home. Anybody else gotten into The Chosen? Oh, we need more hands up. Aaron and I watch it regularly, and it's free online. You can just go and watch it. And I love the way that it details the daily life of Jesus and the disciples. The area that they live, how it's portrayed. You get to see the humanness of the interactions that are going on. You see visually and hear how rabbis are treated in their role in society, how Pharisees and zealots act. You get to see why tax collectors have a special category of sin in their life. You see what traveling looks like. You see how multicultural Israel was back then, how commerce worked. You get to see how scrolls were kept. Record keeping isn't new. It's there, and it gives me so much confidence in our Bible. It's a great show, and you all should watch it. The other thing it helps understand is the impact of the Roman Empire had over Israel. There's this constant tension throughout the show of living the daily Jewish life and just wanting to be left alone from this Roman occupiers. They're trying so hard to hold to their teachings and their traditions, but the rulers just don't care, and they make nothing easy for the Jews to follow God. Even amongst the religious teachers, you see that this is a huge problem for them. The Romans, we hate them. If they would just go away, our problem would go away. Things would be good, how they should be. The new disciples that follow Jesus, they are expecting Jesus is going to lead a revolution that overthrows Rome. The more he teaches and the more they see it, it gets them excited. How is this going to happen, that Rome is going to be defeated? Even when they're beginning to understand this is Jesus, that's all they see. What will the result of Jesus conquering be? Freedom from Rome. I don't know if they did polling back then, but if they did, I would expect if they were asked the question, if the Messiah came today, what would you want to be saved from? That 90%+ of the population would have said, Rome. This was the problem that they felt. The Jews had figured out how to be God's people. They weren't worried about that part of things. That side was good. Rabbis taught. People learned. The Torah was read. Sacrifices were made. Their place with God was good. They were happy with it. And so they had no thought to think of anything other than the physical problem right in front of them. Romans. What would our answer be if we were asked the same question? What do you need saving from today? Where does your mind go with the question? The carbon tax increase on April 1st? Everything will be fine if that's gone. The question I had asked earlier, is Jesus real? Yeah, 100%. Question two was, so then will he save me? The answer is yes, but will he save you from what? Sorry, the answer is yes, but what he will save you from might not be what you expect. Jesus will save you, but he might not save you from what you expect. So we're going to get to the root of what we need saving from. Let's go back to the beginning where this need originated. Genesis chapter 1 starts with the creation of the world, and on the sixth day, God made mankind. He told them to rule over everything and to multiply. Then in Genesis chapter 2, it goes from this big picture to this kind of specific picture of Adam and Eve. And it's there that we first get this amazing language that we see of the presence of God. God is with them. God breathed into Adam life. God took a rib out of Adam and he put that rib into Eve. I love this, that he brought her to the man. It's this imagery of walking down the aisle, the bride, God walking Eve to Adam. There's presence and relationship there. The idea of presence continues to grow in chapter 3, where Eve says to the serpent, now as she's talking, she says, God did say. It's showing that, Boy, Eve had conversations with God. She was talking with them. And then this verse happens after they've eaten the fruit in Genesis 3:8. It says, "Then the man and his wife heard the sound of the Lord as he was walking in the garden in the cool of the day. And they hid from the Lord God among the trees of the garden." So along with relationship, chapter 3 now is introducing us to sin. But we see that God's presence is there. If you flip over to Genesis chapter 4, that language continues, but it's different. It says in verse 3 and 4, "Cain and Abel make an offering to the Lord." And then at the very end of chapter 4, the very last verse, it says, "At that time, people began to call on the name of the Lord." So, my thoughts as I read through these four chapters are that before sin, there was this communion, really connected communion between God and Adam and Eve. Sin disrupted that. But God wasn't gone. He still found a way to be known, and he still found a way to be worshiped. But it was from a distance. So what really was the problem? Genesis 3, 22 to 24, it says, "And the Lord God said, 'The man has now become like one of us, knowing good and evil. He must not be allowed to reach out his hand and take also from the tree of life and eat and live forever.' So the Lord God banished him from the Garden of Eden to work the land that he had come from. After he drove out the man, he placed on the east side of the Garden of Eden cherubim and a flaming sword flashing back and forth to guard the way to the tree of life." They were banished from the place God was. I think this is the greatest loss in this. It was the ability that they had to be walking side by side with God. They couldn't be in his presence anymore. God made sure they weren't going to come near him by placing those two secret agent angel cherubim and the flaming sword, an impenetrable barrier between the presence of God and man had been established. Losing the ability to be in the presence of God was the great cost of sin. There was a barrier, and that is what we needed saving from. We're going to skip ahead 2,500 years. The Ark of the Covenant represented the presence of God and the covenant with his people. It was made in the desert after Moses received the Ten Commandments. And eventually, the Ark of the Covenant found its resting place in the temple, in the Holy of Holies. Traditional Judaism would say that the Holy of Holies is the place where the presence of God dwells. It dwelt in the Garden of Eden, and now it is dwelling in the Holy of Holies. And guarding his presence was the veil, the big curtain that prevented anybody from entering this room. This room would only be entered once a year by the high priest on the Day of Atonement, or as the Jews call it, Yom Kippur. It was the day of the payment for sins. Otherwise, God's presence was still not something people had access to. Like the secret agent angels, the flaming sword in the garden, the veil was now the barrier to God. Let's jump again. Matthew 27. This chapter is almost entirely prophecies being fulfilled. We're going to start in verse 38. Now remember, what did the people want to be rescued from? Rome. Matthew 27, verse 38. "Two rebels were crucified with him, one on his right and one on his left. Those who passed by hurled insults, shaking their heads and saying, You who are going to destroy the temple and build it in 3 days, save yourself. Come down from the cross if you are the Son of God. They didn't understand what they needed saving from. In the same way, the chief priests, the teachers of the law, and the elders mocked him. He saved others, they said, but he can't save himself. He's the King of Israel. Let him come down now from the cross, and we will believe in him. They didn't understand what they needed to be saved from. He trusts in God. I'm at verse 43. Let God rescue him now if he wants him. For he said, I am the Son of God. And in the same way, the rebels who were crucified with him also heaped insults on him. They didn't understand what they needed saving from. From noon until 3 p.m, darkness came over all the land. About 3 p.m, Jesus cried out in a loud voice, Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani, which means, my God, why have you forsaken me? When some of those standing there heard this, they said, he's calling Elijah. And immediately, one of them ran and got a sponge. He filled it with wine vinegar, put it on a staff, and offered it to Jesus to drink. The rest said, now leave him alone. Let's see if Elijah comes to save him. They didn't understand what they needed saving from. And when Jesus had cried out again in a loud voice, he gave up his spirit. Verse 51. At that moment, the curtain of the temple was torn in two from top to bottom. At what moment? The moment he gave up his spirit and died. What happened? The presence of God among us was restored. This is awesome. Our access to walking and talking with God was restored. Was it through his resurrection? Was it through his ascension? No. It was through his suffering and his death on the cross. It was through the cross. Again, Professor Raw, he helps explain this theology of suffering. None of us want to be sufferers. Listen to how he phrases this. It's not a theology of losing. It is one of a warrior, a conqueror. It recognizes the existence of oppression and evil, and so it fights. It fights for the salvation of people. It fights for survival. It comes from the realization of scarcity and the need of a savior. This is the theology of suffering. It's the theology of the cross. First Corinthians 6:19 says, don't you realize that your body is the temple, the Holy Spirit? So my question is, do you have a veil? Because it's hard to get past the, I want to know Jesus and the power of the resurrection, and I want to go to heaven. But is there a veil there that is preventing Jesus from shining out through you? Because this idea of suffering, of dying with Jesus, it's hard. But what happens when Jesus did it? Access to him. What happens when we die to ourselves, to those selfish things that we're pursuing, to all the things the world will tell us are okay for Christians to have, because you believe in Jesus, He's paid for your sins and you'll be in heaven, so you don't need to worry. That veil stays. Red Deer, Central Alberta needs Jesus. And the more we are willing to participate in his suffering and in his death, the more the veil is showing others around Jesus. And the result is this. What would we give up to see Red Deer gather like this? It took Jesus a lot. There's no three easy steps. There's no just if you take a little shift towards. When Jesus started his ministry, he went and he called people and he said, I want you to put down your nets, your identity, your way of life, all you know. I want you to get up from the table, that place that has made you rich and comfortable and powerful, and I want you to follow me. This is seismic. This is the call to become a warrior who will suffer and die to themselves so that Jesus shines through you. Lose your life so that Jesus is the only life people see when they look at you. The Jesus I want to be like, he said, you got to take up your cross. He said you'll have to suffer. He said you will have to lose your life if you want to gain the one he has for me. It's not easy being a camp director. Doesn't get me many benefits in this life, but I would give up more for this to continue to happen in people's life. In church, I'm calling each and every one of you. Join Paul as he says, I want to know Christ. Yeah, I want to know his resurrection. But I'm going to be a participant in his suffering, becoming like him in death, so that the veil is open and this world will know that Jesus is real and he will save you from what you need saving from. Lord, thank you for this morning. Thank you for being here amongst us. Lord, I thank you how this has just changed my Good Friday so much. This is the day the game was won. This is the day that the big goal was scored, and we get to celebrate with you in it. Oh, God, it's exciting. I thank you. I thank you that from the very beginning that you knew that we needed to be in your presence, and you just worked so hard over so many years through so many people to make a way for us to be in your presence. And so, Lord, we're not doing this on our own. We're not doing this scared. We're doing it with you because you're here. You're not in some room we have to find. You're not guarded by angels. You're calling to us, come stand with me. Lord, I just pray that you will give us victory. Help us embrace this theology of the cross. Help us to become warriors in whatever way, and just to be able to say, your will be done is more important than mine. Thank you for this church, Father God. Fill it with stories of people being bold in the places that you have placed them, showing your goodness to all of those that they encounter. And may we be changed forever from the inside out from your presence. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. I just invite you to stand. We're going to sing a song of response. washing over all our sin. The people sing. The people sing. Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. I see a generation rising up to take their place in selfless faith. Selfless faith. I see a near revival stirring as we pray and seek. We're on our knees. We're on our knees. Hosanna, Hosanna.
Amen. Thanks so much, Kory, for that good challenge and that good reminder of the cross. And even as we go through this week preparing for Good Friday, do take time to consider the cost at the cross for Christ and also what he's calling us to do and what he's calling us to do individually in terms of what to give up or where he's calling us to serve. What a great reminder and a great challenge. And Kory will be in the back there if you've got questions about Camp Silversides as well. Let's take a moment to pray. Lord, you see our hearts. We invite your work in us to change us, Lord. Help us to see more clearly what's going on around us in the spiritual realm and what you're calling us to do as individuals, where you're calling us to serve and to give our lives. Increase our desire, Lord. Give us the grace and the strength to serve you in that way this week. Thank you. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Go in God's grace. Dismissed.
Thank you.